Port of Boston. The modernization of Boston Harbor begins with the erection of the first Boston Light. Its seaborne commerce steadily increased until just before the opening of the Seven Years' War, our French and Indian War. It was the principal port on the Atlantic coast. This prosperity continued until the troubles with Great Britain ended and the blockade of Boston was revived after the British raised the siege and was again halted during the War of 1812. Boston Light. While a chorus of ringing hammers mingled with the screeching of winches and capstans, Boston's waterfront echoed to the tune of a popular ditty. Wide awake, Downeasters, no mistake, Downeasters, old Massachusetts will carry the day. Hoisting sail and anchor, crews shouted the challenging chanty, proud in the knowledge that Boston seagoing vessels numbered 194 against New York's 124, that her skilled craftsmen plying their trade in the town's 14 shipyards were constantly augmenting the fleet, that her fishermen were reaping generous bounties from the banks of the North Atlantic. The doggerel boasted Boston's faith that wealth and riches would be won by sailing ships to the southern and middle colonies, to Europe and Africa, to the sugar plantations of the West Indies, and many another tropical isle. Successive improvements made the waterfront and harbor area ever more commodious. 78 wharves in 1708 jutted into the harbor along the Boston and Charlestown waterfront, the most impressive long wharf undertaken by Oliver Noyes. Anthony Stoddard, John George, Daniel Oliver, and other businessmen, was completed in 1710 and set a new standard in the port's facilities. Enabling vessels of any drought or burden to load and unload without lighterage, the finished structure extended from the bottom of King's, now State Street, 800 feet out into the harbor. More than 30 years later, after the wharf was doubled in length, an English traveler spoke in admiration of this engineering feat, a fine wharf about half a mile in length. Another epochal event in the development of the harbor was the establishment of Boston Light, the first lighthouse in the colonies. Headed by the Boston merchant John George, the enterprise had been set in motion by a petition addressed to the general court. The details of the sponsorship and completion of Boston Light appeared in the Boston Newsletter of September 17, 1716. By virtue of an act of assembly made in the first year of His Majesty's reign for building and maintaining a lighthouse upon Great Brewster, called Beacon Island, at the entrance of the harbor of Boston, in order to prevent the loss of lives and estates of His Majesty's subjects, the said lighthouse has been built, and on Friday last, the 14th current, the light was kindled, which will be very useful for all vessels going out and coming into the harbor of Boston or any other harbors in the Massachusetts Bay. Early pictures show that Boston's first lighthouse was a tall, commanding structure with a tower of rough-cut stone. The rays proceeded from wicks immersed in fish or whale oil within large lamps. The chief difficulties with this lighting device were excessive smokiness and the fire hazard from dripping oil. It is doubtful whether the first beacon in the harbor was even provided with reflectors. Maintenance costs for the lighthouse were derived from charges imposed on incoming and outgoing vessels. The fees were 1 penny per ton for ships in overseas trade, 5 shillings per year for fishing vessels and ships in local trade, and 2 shillings for coasters on clearance only. Boston as a commercial port. Life took on new style and color in Boston as the 18th century developed. The rich merchant families enjoyed ease and luxury with their Negro servants and fine coaches. They were the exclusive patrons of the tailoring, wig-making, and silversmithing establishments set up by indentured servants from the mother country. Scarlet uniforms, gold braid, powdered wigs, ruffles, and hoop skirts superseded the somber garb of the Puritan. The royal governors created an English atmosphere in the fashionable North End, where "how is this done at court?" became the question on the lips of wealthy shipowners and their wives. The Boston traders enjoyed life to the full in their mansions at Boston and their roomy country palaces at Milton, Cambridge, or even in far-off Hopkinton. They derived pleasure from cruises along the coast and found relaxation in trout fishing. Owning the goods, the factories, and the ships, the mercantile quality expected and received deference from the lower classes. They were inclined to rule the community according to the law of the sea, but traders could not impose upon the populace the unquestioning obedience seamen gave to shipmasters. Despite the more lavish mode of living, many of the older Puritan habits of conduct and demeanor remained rigidly in force in the early 1700s. Sunday travel and amusement were forbidden. Strolling along the streets and on the mall was taboo. All unnecessary public conversation was forbidden. Whatever orders the Boston merchants might give to the masters of their ships ashore all showed uniform dignity, business integrity, and benevolence. To a man, the shipowners were staunch church members. Some outsiders, however, dared to question the sincerity of conviction beneath the Bible reading and church going of the Boston people. One Englishman even asserted that there were more religious zealots than honest men in the town, and added that the citizens, though they wear in their faces the innocence of doves, you will find them in their dealings as subtle as serpents. Peter Faneuil, a leading merchant of the times and donor of Faneuil Hall, lived in a style that blazoned his lofty position in society. His magnificent estate was centrally located near King's Chapel. His appearances in public were in the handsomest manner. His household furnishings revealed his refined bachelor tastes and included the latest European importations. He ordered from London firm 3 gold watches, 1 dozen French knives, 1 dozen silver spoons, 1 dozen silver forks with 3 prongs with my arms cut upon them, and 6 razors. His palate was never long neglected. Tripe, bacon, and citron water were often on the list. Faneuil gravely asked Lane and Smithhurst of London to send him the latest best book of the several sorts of cookery, which pray let be of the largest character for the benefit of the maids reading. When he shipped a pair of gray horses to St. Kitts, the proceeds were returnable, partly in sweets for his sister Marianne, and partly in sugar and molasses. He bought a chariot and demanded from his London agent 4 horses, right good or none. A sybarite, and yet an unstinting benefactor, his gifts to private charity were large, his public ones more lasting. After a training in the best mercantile tradition of careful yet enterprising trade, Faneuil carried on a general commission and shipping business. Operating the vessels Providence, Friends Adventure, and Rochelle, he received goods from agents in Bristol, London, Bordeaux, Cadiz, Hamburg, and Kingston, Jamaica, and exported cargoes of rum, fish, produce, as well as newly constructed ships. Faneuil engaged extensively in coastal commerce, especially in New York. Whenever he ventured both ship and cargo, the enterprise was almost always shared with his brother, uncles, friends, or correspondents. He charged 5% for handling a consignment, whether it was fish oil or a bag of gold. An early advocate of modern business methods, Faneuil stationed near the fishing grounds agents, who were constantly kept informed as to the price of fish in Massachusetts markets. His emissaries also acted as advertising men in extending his commercial connections. Seeking to protect his wealth from a fluctuating currency, Faneuil exhibited genuine business acumen in the purchase of Bank of England stock, amounting to £14,800. His meticulous account books reveal that, though he dunned debtors with proper vigilance, he submitted reluctantly to the 2.5% charged him by his friend and New York correspondent, Julian Verplank. His eyes always remained open to see that men everywhere act the honest and just part by me. Making large profits from the sale of smuggled European commodities, Faneuil considered a judge of the Admiralty who scanned too closely his shipping operations a vile man. Charles Apthorpe, Thomas Boylston, and Thomas Amory also stood out among the wealthy shipping merchants of the town. They operated vessels sailing to the Mediterranean, West Indies, and Europe, as well as fishing boats, whalers, and coasters. Supplementing their maritime activities, they underwrote insurance, speculated in land on a grand scale, and engaged in private banking. Some indication of the magnitude of Boston's trade was seen in the great fortunes amassed by these men. Through his maritime ventures, Thomas Boylston became one of the richest men in Massachusetts, with extensive possessions estimated in excess of £80,000. Charles Apthorpe, when he died in 1758, aged 60, left to his heirs an estate of £50,000. Thomas Amory, rum distiller, shipbuilder, bold and able trader, accumulated by shrewd management investments valued at £20,000, aside from a brewery, a wharf, a beautiful home, and large land holdings in Carolina and the Azores. Ever wary for his good name, he was explicit in his counsel to agents abroad. To his representative in the Azores, he wrote, "Now, if the above people sent for these effects sell anything that belongs to me, or take money at interest on my account so that you continue to discharge them, for I had rather be a loser anyway than have my reputation in question abroad."